Hi, my name is Johan Norberg. I am a writer and an analyst born and raised in Sweden. Here in the United States, I encounter great concern about our growing need for energy and its costs, financial and environmental. Many people worry about the continued availability of energy, and most people worry about environmental pollution and global warming. It seems like all sides are adopting extreme positions. Some shout, drill baby drill, while others claim that we are poisoning the planet and ruining it for our children. It's difficult to have a balanced discussion about the choices we are facing. All life needs energy. Energy is the ability to move matter, to do anything. We live in a time of abundant energy, available to all of us in developed nations. We take it for granted. It's almost a right. It lights our homes. It powers our cars. But it's more. It's actually the vehicle that raises our living standards, lengthens our lives, and helps give us fulfillment. All progress, every material advance of civilization, from lighting and transport to factories and healthcare, has been powered by energy. Whatever we do next, whether we create full immersion virtual reality or cure cancer, extend lifespans even further or go into space, it'll take more energy, not less. The problem is that all the energy sources have their limitations and environmental impacts. There are problems and benefits with them all. Let's have a look. Coal is fossilized land plants that have been buried deep in the earth for millions of years. The pressure and the intense heat at those depths have turned vegetation into a hard black material that is primarily carbon.
One of the biggest pros about coal is there's a lot of it. It has been a workhorse fuel supply for the past 200 years.
Around 40% of the world's electricity is based on coal. Incredibly, around 5% of all energy used in the United States is simply to transport coal so it can be burned as a fuel.
It's about half of our electricity production starting to be less than that now as coal plants come offline. Coal's going to have to continue to be part of our mix just because it's so abundant.
Coal consumption is now increasing rapidly in developing countries. China now burns almost as much coal as the rest of the world combined.
Its cons are largely environmental, not just the typical air pollutants, but also, obviously, the high greenhouse gas footprint.
It is one of the leading causes of smog, acid rain, and other toxic substances. And it is the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases. Coal mining is also a major factor in the destruction of land and waters.
Coal burning might keep going up for a little while, but the top of coal burning is in sight.
And then there's something we all pay a lot for, especially here in Europe, and that's oil, primarily used for transportation. But a small percentage of it is also used to generate electricity. Just like coal, it comes from organic material, fossilized eons ago. Worldwide, it makes up about a third of the energy supply.
We really don't use much oil in the electric sector, maybe 1 or 2% as a backup fuel.
Proven oil reserves today are actually 70% higher than they were 20 years ago, even though a lot of oil has been consumed during that time. But oil generates carbon dioxide, and it also causes pollution at every stage of the process, from mining and refining to using it as a fuel. And oil spills have a dramatic impact on wildlife. Another problem is that we often rely on some of the most authoritarian regimes in the world to satisfy our demand for oil.
The supply is going to stay tight, the price is going to stay high, most likely, but it's going to remain a very relevant fuel for quite some time to come, I think.
Natural gas is also abundant, but unlike coal and oil, it's virtually clean, and it's comparatively cheap and easy to build a gas-fired power station.
Natural gas is a very dense fossil fuel. It produces a lot of energy. It has a lower pollution footprint and lower carbon footprint than coal.
20% of the world's energy supply comes from gas, and it has grown rapidly to 27% of the total energy used here in the United States, and 30% of the electricity.
There's no question that natural gas is a game changer in the electricity sector. We're finding deep reserves of natural gas. We have new technology to get it out of the ground.
With hydraulic fracturing for natural gas, there are also some local problems of groundwater contamination, the use of chemicals, and concerns about methane leakage.
Natural gas in the U.S. has been a good thing for the environment, but we can and should and make sure that we're doing everything we can to stop those leaks and capture those leaks and use it in the right way.
Nuclear energy is the energy from the nucleus, the core of the atom. In a nuclear reactor, atoms are split to release that energy. Nuclear supplies 5% of the world's energy and 14% of its electricity.
So today we have 100 nuclear power reactors that generate 20% of US power.
Here in Sweden, it provides around 40% of the electricity. In France, it's more than 70%. Nuclear power is one of few large-scale alternatives to fossil fuels.
Nuclear is carbon-free energy that works 24/7, doesn't need storage.
Nuclear energy produces 62% of all the carbon-free electricity generated in this country.
From an air pollution and a greenhouse gas perspective, nuclear has very low costs and is very clean. The largest costs are the construction costs associated and the waste containment and disposal.
And even to find the site for a new plant is hugely controversial. From planning to electricity generation might take a decade or more. And although nuclear reactors operating as they should are of minimal environmental concern, events like Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, and Fukushima show that when something really goes wrong, the impact on society can be dramatic. Hydropower has many benefits. It is clean. It doesn't produce greenhouse gases or add pollutants to rivers and streams. It's fairly cheap, and since we can turn the turbines on and off in minutes, it's online whenever we need it.
So hydro, again, about 10% of today's electricity in the US. Some areas of the country, like the Pacific Northwest and New England, you know, very dependent.
And large dams generate almost a fifth of the world's electrical power. About 17% of all American rivers have dams that generate electricity. In total, there are some 2,400 dams in the United States. In China, there is 10 times that number.
On the environmental side, facilitating hydroelectric generation means damming flowing bodies of water, and that can have ecosystem implications.
And if a dam doesn't have fish ladders like this one, it obstructs the migration of salmon and other fish. Perhaps the biggest problem is that in developed nations, almost all the suitable sites for large hydroelectrical dams are already in use. So it's difficult to see how we can expand it much further. In my own country, Sweden, we have seen a revival of what might be called mankind's first energy source, burning wood, or rather using biomass. Around the world, almost 10% of the energy supply comes from using biomass or waste. When we grow our fuel, from wood to corn or algae, or burn waste, that's called biomass. In my hometown of Malmö, biomass produces 40% of the city's heat.
The thing that appeals to me about biomass and things like anaerobic digesters for dairy waste is that you're killing two birds with one stone. You're using a waste stream as an energy source.
Still, bioenergy tends to be more expensive than the alternatives. And the large-scale use of biomass demands that huge areas of land be set aside.
The end of the oil age will come when we have some renewable replacement for oil. We should be able to do it, but we haven't figured out the engineering to do it at scale yet. Someday someone will. That person will make a fortune and do a huge value for the planet, but we don't know who it's going to be or what year it's going to be.
It's difficult to think of a cleaner way of generating power than harnessing the wind. But currently, wind supplies no more than 1% of energy globally and less than 4% of the electricity. Some countries have gone much further. Turbines like these here in Denmark supply the country with almost a third of its electricity needs.
Wind power is really emerging as a significant electricity source. Obviously, there are some regions where wind works and some regions where it doesn't.
We would have to build 80 new wind turbines like this every day, just to match the annual increase in carbon dioxide emissions from China's coal. The biggest drawback is that wind is intermittent. The wind doesn't blow all the time. And everybody knows that the wind must be strong enough for the generators to function at full capacity. Many people also object to how wind turbines affect the beauty of the landscape.
You can't flip it on and off with a switch. Wind facilities have to be backed up with, typically with a natural gas generator.
There's people working on windmills that can work with winds as low as 3 or 4 miles per hour. There's technologies of all sorts coming along all the time.
Every hour of every day, the sun beams more than enough energy onto our planet to satisfy global electricity demands for an entire year.
Solar is also a fuel source that the electricity industry is really expanding into in terms of large commercial solar installations.
30 years ago, solar cells could only convert a few percent of sunlight to electricity. Today, off-the-shelf solar arrays convert 20% and more. The cost to install solar photovoltaic systems have dropped 40% in 3 years. On the plus side, solar energy is clean and abundant. You can do it small scale, from a few watts to recharge a cell phone, to large scale, hundreds of megawatts for industrial generation. And you can do it in remote locations, far from the grid. But it does have negatives. It doesn't work when the sun doesn't shine. And even though costs are dropping, it's still expensive to install.
Another cost of solar is the energy intensity required in the production of the solar PV panels.
One of the elements that you don't hear about very much with solar is what do you do with the back end, and you have to dispose of cadmium and some of the toxic elements that are used there.
Another cost that is common to both wind and solar is the lack of storage.
But there is a way to generate electricity from the sun that doesn't involve solar panels. The desert of Morocco in North Africa has the advantage of strong, bright sunlight. Here at the Noor solar facilities, they use mirrors to heat a liquid and create steam to drive a turbine and generate electricity. And they are able to store the sun's energy. During the day, the liquid heated by these mirrors will also heat salt until it becomes a molten liquid. The stored heat in the salt will power the generators for 5 hours after the sun sets and help Morocco get through its peak power demand in the evening. Morocco has ambitious plans to build major solar facilities, and they are connected to the European grid with cables under the Strait of Gibraltar. They are definitely thinking of exporting electricity.
We have to realize that these technologies are the fastest growing in the world, but they're also a tiny fraction of the amount of energy that we get. So it's at the very dawn, no pun intended, of its value to us as a civilization.
So it's clear, every energy source comes with its own set of problems. But there is another way of looking at this. The potential should be limitless because energy is everywhere. The world is turning, the wind is blowing, and water flows downhill. The world is overflowing with energy. The only bottleneck is our ability to safely convert, store, and pay for it. And we're going to have to figure that out. By 2050, world population will have grown to almost 9 billion. So even with the same living standards, we'll need 25% more energy. And of course, the world's poor are not content with today's living standards. They want better lives. Rich countries won't be able to influence poorer countries to develop in a green way just by turning to more expensive energy sources or by trying to convince them to restrain themselves. But if we can develop better and greener and cheaper energy sources, they will spread around the world in a spontaneous way. So it seems to me like the world needs more crazy dreamers, people who are venturing into new territory, exploring strange new ideas. Most of them will be failures, but it only takes a few to change the world. And we are going to have to change the world. Because we will need more energy in the future to power the next steps mankind will take, and to make sure that everyone around the world gets the chance for a good life, free from poverty. It's tempting to go looking for that one best solution to the energy problem. But the simple and surprising answer is that there is no one best source. What's best changes with where you live, and it changes over time.
There is no energy source that is perfect. Every energy source has a negative, or at least a limitation.
There are no silver bullets. Everything has trade-offs, and there are no easy answers.
We can get through this. We may be destructive as a race, but we're also incredibly inventive. Tens of thousands of scientists and entrepreneurs are right now hard at work, trying to develop brand new energy sources and perfect amazing technologies, because they think they have the key to the future. And at least one of them is probably right.